everybody. I am Dr. Indulata, Assistant Professor from Department of Maternal and Reproductive Health, AGPGIMS, Lucknow, UP, India. Today I am giving lecture on anemia in pregnancy, especially the management part. So, what is the definition of anemia? Anemia is a reduction in the number of RBCs and hemoglobin content with a corresponding reduction in the oxygen carrying capacity of the blood. According WHO, what is the definition? The hemoglobin less than 11 gram per dl and hematocrit less than 33% is known as anemia in pregnancy. And another classification given by the Center for Disease Control and Prevention, US, the classification given trimester wise, in first and third trimester, when the hemoglobin is less than 11 gram per dl and hematocrit less than 33% gram, then it is known as anemia in pregnancy. And for second trimester, the hemoglobin value is less than 10.5 gram per dl and hematocrit less than 32%. According Indian Council Medical Research, the severity of anemia is divided in mild, moderate, severe and very severe. The mild, when the hemoglobin level is 10 to 10.9, moderate 7 to 10, severe less than 7 and very severe when hemoglobin level is less than 4 gram per dl. According WHO, only moderate, severe and very severe categories are present. In moderate group, hemoglobin 7 to 10.9 and hematocrit less than 24 to 37%. In severe degree, when the hemoglobin level is less than hemoglobin level is 4 to 6.9 and hematocrit is 13 to 23%. In very severe category, when the hemoglobin is less than 4 and hematocrit is less than 13%. In prevalence of India, according WHO worldwide, is 42%. And in developing countries, it is 52%, and in developed countries, it is 20%. India is on the topmost with 88%, and Africa is on second number with 50%, Latin America 40%, and Caribbean countries 30%. Type of anemia. In type of anemia, there is three type of anemia: iron deficiency anemia, megaloblastic anemia, and hemolytic anemia. In megaloblastic anemia, there are two types due to deficiency of folic acid and vitamin B12. Anemia can be due to physiological causes of cause and pathological cause. In pathological cause, there may be deficiency of iron, folic acid, vitamin B12. There may be hemorrhagic anemia due to antepartum hemorrhage, hookworm infestation, hereditary anemia due to thalassemia, sickle cell anemia, hemolytic anemia, and bone marrow insufficiency due to aplastic anemia. And in infections, there may be due to anemia may be due to malaria and tuberculosis, and chronic renal disease and due to neoplasm. The iron requirement during whole pregnancy to cover up the RBC's formation in the mother is 500 milligram for fetus and placenta, 450 milligram in third stage, blood loss 200 milligram. So there is total iron requirement during whole pregnancy is 1150 milligram. So we can say iron requirement for normal pregnancy is approximately 1 gram during whole pregnancy. Approximately 80% of all anemias in pregnancy results from iron deficiency anemia. The symptoms of anemia may be irritability, fatigue, weakness, dizziness, palpitations, infections, and lack of concentration. And signs are pallor of skin and mucosal membrane, edema, platinikia, cholinikia, glossitis, stomatitis, tachycardia, and soft ejection systolic murmur. Due to anemia, there may be complications in pregnancy to the fetus and to the mother. Fetus may have intrauterine growth retardation, intrauterine death, and intrauterine heart hospitalis. And in mother, anemia can cause congestive cardiac failure, infections, preterm labor, medical disorder, and preeclampsia. During labor, the complication may be postpartum hemorrhage, congestive cardiac failure, fetal distress, and there is increased chances of instrumental delivery, which leads to maternal and perinatal increased morbidity and mortality. So why the prophylactic supplementation is necessary? Approximately 1 gram iron is required in pregnancy, and there is daily requirement is 4 to 6 milligram per day, which rises to 8 milligram per day in last 3 weeks of pregnancy. And in average Indian diet, only provide only 15 milligram of elemental iron per day, from which only 10% is absorbed. So every woman, every pregnant woman needs iron supplementation, no matter how adequate her diet is in terms of protein and calories. The choice of therapy depends on severity of anemia, gestational age of pregnant patient, associated complicating factors, and cause of anemia. The aim of iron therapy in pregnant patients is to normalize the hemoglobin level and restore the iron stores. For prophylaxis, we should treat the cause of anemia before conception, pre-pregnancy balanced diet, education and health support, build up the iron stores during adolescent phase, avoid frequent childbirth, minimum spacing should be 3 years, supplementary iron therapy, dietary advice, treatment of predisposing factors like hookworm infestations, malaria, urinary tract infections and piles. There should be early detection of falling hemoglobin level. Hemoglobin level should be estimated at least 3 times at first antenatal visit, at 30 weeks and finally at 36 weeks of pregnancy. The treatment of hookworm infestation given by mebendazole 100 mg twice a day for 3 days and albendazole 400 mg once a day for 3 days. There should be improvement of sanitation and personal hygiene. And Government of India approved the production of iron fortified salts, so these type of salts should be used. WHO recommends that if there is prevalence of anemia more than 40%, less than 40%, then 60 mg elemental iron plus 250 microgram folic acid should be given for 6 months. And where the prevalence of anemia is more than 40%, then same doses should be given for 6 months and 3 months postpartum also. In India, in 1971-72, National Nutritional Anemia Prophylaxis Program has been started, and the beneficiaries are pregnant women, lactating women, children less than 12 years, and contraceptive users. So they were recommended the 100 mg of elemental iron plus 500 microgram of folic acid for at least 100 days. So the management of anemia in pregnant patient according gestational age is like that. When the gestational age is less than 30 weeks and if there is iron deficiency anemia, oral iron is advised, and if there is intolerance or non-compliance to oral iron, then intramuscular or intravenous iron therapy is given. In folic acid deficiency, oral folate is advised. When the gestational age is 30 to 36 weeks, in iron deficiency anemia, it is better to give parenteral iron by intramuscular or intravenous route, and in folic acid deficiency, oral folate is given. The oral therapy has unpredictable absorption and poor compliance, hence parenteral therapy is preferred. In gestation more than 36 weeks, blood transfusion is preferred. For anemia, in therapeutic options, iron and blood transfusion. Iron can be given oral and parenteral therapy, and in parenteral therapy, there is two routes, intramuscular and intravenous. The therapy is considered effective when there is increased production of RBCs proportional to severity of anemia and amount of iron available. The response to iron therapy evaluated with rise in reticulocyte index, hemoglobin and hematocrit levels. Rise is seen within 1 week of therapy. Decision about effectiveness can be made after 3 to 4 weeks. Increase by 2 g% of hemoglobin level is considered as adequate response. If response is inadequate, then reconsider the diagnosis, look for other causes of anemia. If response is adequate, then continue iron till hemoglobin normalizes. Treatment should be extended to establish iron stores. In oral therapy, there is no scientific evidence that one form is better than the other. It is better to start simple preparation, and these are cheap, so there is a good cost factor. Slow release preparation claim lesser side effects but expensive. Slow release preparation are formulated for slow release of iron as the tablet passes through the gastrointestinal tract, thus avoiding increased concentration at one site. There are different iron preparations for oral therapy are ferrous sulfate, ferrous gluconate, ferrous fumarate and sustained release ferrous sulfate. In all type of iron in 300 mg, the elemental iron quantity is different. Like in ferrous sulfate in 360 mg, elemental iron is present. In ferrous gluconate in 333 mg%. In ferrous fumarate in 300 mg%, and in sustained release ferrous sulfate 350 mg of tablet having 105 mg elemental iron. Factor affecting absorption. So the absorption is increased by gastric acid, citrate, vitamin C and amino acids. Increased by in presence of tea, tannins, oxalate, phytate, phosphates, calcium, milk, antacid and in achlorhydria and hyperchlorhydria like conditions. The ferrous sulfate is preparation of choice because of high absorption. It is cheapest and available in free of cost in most government hospitals in India. The treatment is one tab thrice a day, that is 180 mg elemental iron per day it provides. Smaller doses I started 1 to 2 tab per day and continued for 3 to 6 months to replenish the stores of iron. There are two forms of iron, ferrous form and ferric form. In ferrous form are more soluble, easier to absorb, and the preparations are ferrous sulfate, ferrous fumarate, ferrous gluconate. The ferric forms are less soluble and converted to ferrous to be absorbed. The absorption of ferrous sulfate The iron salts are dissociated into bivalent or trivalent iron ions, and these free ions diffuse through the upper part of the gastrointestinal mucosa and taken up by the transferrin and incorporated into ferritin. For binding to ferritin and transferrin, ferrous ion has to be removed have to be converted into ferric ion by oxidation, and highly reactive free radicals are produced in this process. All ionic iron, including carbonyl iron, are absorbed similarly. In this diagram, we can see there is gut lumen, mucosal cell, and blood. The iron salt, when come in gut lumen, it is dissociated in ferrous ions, and these ferrous ions pass to mucosal cell by passive diffusion, and in presence of free radical, these are converted into ferric ion, and these ferric ion is incorporated into transferrin, which is a transport protein, to the blood, and then these ferric ion is incorporated into ferritin in ferric form, and whenever there is requirement of formation of hemoglobin, then these ferric ion is converted into ferrous ion by releasing free radicals. Response is proportional to hemoglobin level before treatment. So there will be sense of well-being, increased appetite, and reticulocytosis can be seen in 7 to 10 days, and the rate of rise of hemoglobin will be around 0.7 to 1 gram per week. Improvement evident in 2 to 3 weeks. The side effects of oral therapy are epigastric pain, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, and constipation. To minimize these side effects, we should commence therapy with a smaller dose, 1 tab per day, gradually increasing to 3 tabs per day. We can change the salt preparation and can start with meal or immediately after meals. Iron can be discontinued if symptoms are troublesome, or we can discontinue the iron therapy for a few days. Therapy can be restarted with 1 tab with meals for 1 week, 2 tab daily for the next week, and then 3 tab daily can be continued. There is new iron preparation that is known as carbonyl iron. Carbonyl refers to the manufacturing process in which there is controlled heating of vaporized iron, pentacarbonyl, which leads to deposition of uncharged elemental iron as submicroscopic crystals that form microscopic spheres of less than 5 micrometer diameter. Because carbonyl iron is dependent upon gastric acid for absorption, it enters the body more gradually than other forms of iron. It is less toxic and better tolerated than any other forms of iron. The brand name nowadays are of carbonyl iron are Carboflot, Conviron, Carbofer Z. The new iron preparation is ferrous ascorbate, in which the ascorbic acid reduces ferric to ferrous form, with remains soluble even at neutral pH. The conversion of ferric to ferrous ion is further aided by gastric acid. The ascorbic acid enhances the absorption of iron in these preparations, and there is no dissociation of ferrous ascorbate on entering in GIT due to stable chelate of iron with ascorbate. The ferrous ascorbate in comparison to ferrous sulfate is better because it can prevent the ferrous oxidation by ascorbate and existence of ferrous as a chelate with ascorbate. The brand name of ferrous ascorbate in India are Ferinium XT, Levogen XT, and Ferronia XT. The cause for failure of oral therapy is improper typing of anemia, decreased absorption due to GI disorders, non-compliance, concurrent blood loss due to hookworm infestations or by bleeding piles, coexistent folate deficiency, and due to persistent infections. Now the parenteral iron therapy. The route of administration are intramuscular and intravenous. The indication of parenteral iron therapy is intolerance and poor compliance to oral iron, severe anemia in last 8 to 10 weeks of pregnancy. So there is certainty of administration. The gastrointestinal disorders whose symptoms may aggravate by oral iron, like peptic ulcer disease, ulcerative colitis, and malabsorption syndromes. So there is no advantage over oral iron if latter is being tolerated. Rise in hemoglobin, same as with oral therapy, up to 1 gram per week. The dose calculation done by two formulas, by as we are seeing, the elemental iron needed is equal to normal hemoglobin minus patient hemoglobin into weight in kilograms into 2.21 plus 1000 milligram for replacing the iron stores. And the second formula is 250 milligram of elemental iron for each gram of hemoglobin below normal. Now the for parenteral therapy, iron, there are two forms of iron, that is dextran and sorbitol complex. So the iron dextran is collide of ferric hydroxide with dextran. 2, 5 and 20 ml ampules are available, and 1 ml is equal to 50 mg of elemental iron. It can be given by intramuscular or intravenous route. These are slowly absorbed by lymphatics, reaches peak concentration in 24 to 48 hours, taken by hepatic reticular endothelial cells, from where it is transferred to RBCs. The second is iron sorbitol citrate complex, which is given in intramuscular route only. It is rapidly cleared from the injection site due to its small size. 30% of sorbitol citrate complex is excreted in urine, and 1 ml of iron sorbitol is equal to 50 mg of elemental iron, and it is available in 2 ml of ampule. The contraindication for parenteral therapy is if there is history of allergy, asthma, and previous serious reaction to the preparations. The rate of rise of hemoglobin is 0.7 to 1 gram percent per week, and the main advantage of parenteral therapy is certainty of administration. In intramuscular route, we can give iron dextran and iron sorbitol complex both. So we have to stop oral iron 24 hours prior to therapy to avoid reactions by these compounds. The side effect of parenteral therapy is abscess, hematoma, or discoloration of skin at local site, and acute severe systemic reactions like hemolysis, hypotension, circulatory collapse, muscle pain and anaphylactic shock, delayed reaction in form of pyrexia, myalgia and arthralgias, lymphadenopathy, and headache, nausea, vomiting and allergic reactions. In intravenous route, we can give the iron in two forms. In first, the total dose infusion, that is TDI, and in form of repeated injection. For total dose infusion, we can use 10 ml ampules are available, and the advantage of total dose infusion is it eliminates repeated painful intramuscular injections, and treatment is completed in a day, and it has less cost. The disadvantage of total dose infusion or parenteral therapy is maximum response to hemoglobin occurs in 4 to 9 weeks. The method is unsuitable if at least 4 weeks not left for the delivery. Now, the blood transfusion. The World Health Organization states that transfusion should be prescribed only for conditions for which there is no other treatment. Indication for blood transfusion is severe anemia, that is hemoglobin less than 7 gram percent beyond 36 weeks of pregnancy. It improves the anemic state, oxygen carrying capacity of blood allow patient to withstand stress of labor and blood loss during delivery. The other indication is refractory anemia or anemia due to hemorrhages like antepartum hemorrhage or postpartum hemorrhage. In blood transfusion, we can use whole blood or packed red cell blood cells. So whole blood should be fresh blood. It should be typed or cross-matched. 450 to 500 ml can be given at a time, and the bag hematocrit should be between 36 to 44%, and 1 unit blood transfusion will raise hematocrit by 3 to 4% or hemoglobin by 1 gram per dl. 1 unit blood should be transfused in 4 hours to allow time for circulatory readjustment. Transfusion not repeated in 24 hours because it can cause cardiac overload. The packed red blood cells, that is PRBC, the 1 unit of PRBC means 1 unit blood from which 200 to 250 ml of plasma has been removed, and when the only anticoagulants are present, then hematocrit is between 70 to 80%, and when anticoagulant and additives are used, then hematocrit is between 52 to 60%. The advantage of packed red blood cells is it increases oxygen carrying capacity without causing a fluid overload. The advantage of blood transfusion is it increases the oxygen carrying capacity. Hemoglobin from hemolyzed cells can be utilized for formation of new RBCs. It stimulates erythropoiesis. It supplies natural constituent of blood-like protein and antibodies, and the improvement is expected in within 3 days. So the rate of response is around 1 gram per cent, which is seen in 3 days. The precaution during blood transfusion is taken. So transfuse the blood after checking cross-match report, bag number, blood group, date of collection, date of expiry, HIV, hepatitis B, VDRL status of the bag. It should be given slowly, intravenously, and with strict aseptic measures. Antihistaminates, diuretics, hydrocortisone should be kept ready. Monitor vital parameters and look for signs of blood reaction during blood transfusion. The transfusion reactions may be acute or delayed. In acute transfusion reactions, it occurs within 24 hours of transfusion, and these are intravascular hemolysis, fever, allergy, urticaria, transfusion related acute lung injury, which is known as TRALI, bacterial sepsis. In delayed transfusion reactions, delayed hemolytic transfusion reactions, transfusion associated graft versus host reaction, host disease, post transfusion purpura, infections like HIV, HTLV1, HTLV2, hepatitis C, hepatitis B, cytomegalovirus, parvovirus B19, and it can cause the CJD disease or Creutzfeldt Jakob disease. For management of reaction caused due to blood transfusion, first of all stop blood transfusion, then verify the bag of blood and the patient, maintain IVSS, maintain urine output with crystalloid and colloid, maintain blood pressure, pulse and ventilation of the patient, and obtain blood urine for transfusion reaction workup. Then send blood bag and intravenous set to blood bank if intravenous hemolysis is confirmed. Monitor renal status of the kidney by BU and creatinine. Initiate diuresis, urine for hemoglobinuria. Monitor coagulation status, monitor for hemolysis, repeat cross match, and if sepsis is suspected, then do culture of the blood in the bag. The disadvantage of the blood transfusion, it may produce preterm labor, it can cause overload, which may lead to congestive cardiac failure and pulmonary edema and transfusion reactions. So during blood transfusion, blood transfusion is thus started after tocolytic drugs and injection Lasix, 1 ampule intramuscular has been given. The management during labor. In first stage of the labor, oxygen should be given by mask if required. Blood grouping and cross match. IV line is secured. Strict asepsis is maintained and routine care is given. In second stage of labor, strict asepsis is maintained. Methergin is given immediately after birth of anterior shoulder, and prostaglandin F2 alpha injection is kept ready. Third stage of labor, look for postpartum hemorrhage. Use prostaglandin F2 alpha if uterus is atony. Blood transfusion if required, and look for cardiac failure and do not overload the patient because patient is already anemic. During puerperium, look for signs of infections. Adequate antibiotic cover should be given. Iron therapy is continued even after delivery, and re-estimate the hemoglobin prior to discharge of patient from the hospital. Now, role of erythropoietin in pregnancy is less, but it is given in pregnant patient whose kidney are not working properly, and pregnant patient on hemodialysis. Blood transfusion is avoided due to hypertension and circulatory overload. So use of erythropoietin in such patients has obvious advantage and has increased the likelihood of women conceiving and producing a surviving infants. We all know that lack of erythropoietin is predominant cause for anemia in renal disease, and treatment is replacement of recombinant erythropoietin in these patients. Erythropoietin can be given by intravenous and subcutaneous use. Initiating dose with 80 to 120 unit per kg body weight per week subcutaneously, and 50 to 150 unit per kg body weight per week intravenously. The safe rate of hemoglobin correction range from 1 to 2 gram per month. Erythropoietin therapy is more successful when adequate iron are present, and therapeutic iron supplementation can be given along with erythropoietin therapy. In folate deficiency anemia, there is megaloblastic anemia is caused, and for prophylaxis we give 300 to 500 microgram folic acid, which is already present in most of the iron preparations present nowadays, is sufficient for the prophylaxis. For treatment of megaloblastic anemia, we give 5 mg folate per day, which is continued for 4 weeks postpartum. In vitamin B12 deficiency anemia, it also causes the megaloblastic anemia. And for vitamin B12 deficiency, we give cyanocobalamin in 100 microgram intravenous every week for 6 weeks, followed by 100 microgram intramuscular injections every month. So the take home message is, anemia is although preventable, but it is a global problem. It is commonest cause of maternal mortality and morbidity in spite of easy diagnosis and treatment. Anemia can be due to a number of causes including certain diseases or deficiency of iron, folic acid or vitamin B12. It is most common cause of anemia in pregnancy is iron deficiency, and the oral therapy for iron therapy is best. Youth should be educated about diet, sanitation and personal hygiene, and hookworm infestation should be treated if it is present. The pregnant woman should be given iron and folate supplements. Thanks.